Which one do you think is further away, the safety or the expense?
I think safety is probably one of the bigger challenges. And the reason I say that is because safety isn't just about the robot itself. It's about what it's doing. So if you want a robot that can lift and clean and do useful work in your environment, the safety is not only the robot, but it's all the things the robot's interacting with. And I think it's a complicated problem. I think the hardware and the software costs are probably going to be easier to solve than the larger topic of safety.
So we started from machine learning, then traditional AI, and now we're in this generative AI and agentic AI era. How has the field of robotics started to shift from this deterministic to open-ended technology?
I would describe the shifts as tectonic. You know, they're not these like little gradual things. We saw a pretty big shift back when we moved from traditional computer vision to machine learning. And it wasn't too long ago that we were having the same conversations about replacing computer vision algorithm with a machine learning technique. And here we are again, bringing in large language models, foundation models, and they really are changing almost all aspects of how we're approaching programming robots. And that goes from how you interface with a robot through how a robot controls its body. So I think we're seeing the general and rapid progress in AI touch almost all the parts of the robot stack in a pretty exciting and fundamental way.
With generative AI able to answer open-ended questions, how can robots change with that technology?
The open-ended nature of the question is maybe not the most important topic in robotics. It's how the robot acts after it's taken that input, right? So I think the input side could be quite open. Having a conversation with a robot or having a robot make a call to a visual foundation model to get some information back. The question is, how does it take that information and create action? And in that action space, I think there's a lot of uncertainty. I think there's a lot of stuff that we're developing now. So we're in an era where you're seeing examples and demonstrations of all sorts of amazing things. I think there's work to do to get from those demonstrations to something that you really can quantify, qualify, deliver in a way to a customer that you can predict the outcome of those technologies. So I think, you know, maybe on the input side, there's a lot of exciting ways we can take an open-ended interaction with a robot. On the output side, we still have a lot of work to do to make the actions of the robot be predictable and be reliable and be safe.
Yeah, I feel like there's going to be a ton of guardrails that you have to put on, especially with the way generative AI models respond and do things now. You probably have a lot of guardrails because I imagine you can't deliver something like, okay, this is going to work 99% of the time, but 1% of the time, it's not going to do what you're expecting.
Yeah, 99 is not good enough. I think that's a hard thing for roboticists to confront that are on the research or early stage development side. When you deploy a robot, customers aren't okay with 90% or 95%. The other thing that maybe would be a useful concept to unpack here, a lot of people think of AI as a thing, right? A single model that takes that input that you're talking about and commands the output. And although I think there's a future in which there's a single model that does everything, a single model that goes from language input to action output, or a lot of people talk about vision language action models, I think there's a future in which there's a model that could do all of this. But remember, there's other ways to do things. So I think maybe the way that you could start thinking about pulling some of these guardrails in is that you could have an AI model that still, the output of that model still has to go through another stage in your system, and that stage can do smart things. And that stage could be deterministic. That stage could be made with a technology that you can predict and you can qualify. So I think if you think of AI as a bunch of building blocks, and those building blocks can be connected to other types of building blocks, you start to see how we're going to take this new technology and map it into an industrial or home setting where you really need to have predictability and quantified results.
So is there anything that you're expecting that maybe the general public is not expecting in terms of like AI and robotics in the future?
Oh, let's see. There's maybe two sides of that. There's the positive side and yes, there's the negative side.
Positive first.
I think these technologies are going to significantly reduce the barrier for people to interact with robots, whether it's through an LLM and natural language, you're talking to a robot, not writing lines of code, or some other method that maybe makes it more easier for the general population to engage and interact with robots. So I think that's the thing that's probably going to surprise people the most. On the negative side, I think these technologies are amazing at demonstrating potential, but we have a lot of work, as you pointed out right at the beginning, going from from 70 to 80 to 99 to 99.999997, that's a huge challenge for us, right? So I think on the other side, maybe on the side where we have to do expectation management, we may be able to show the potential of one of these technologies quickly, and it might be very, very exciting. But that doesn't mean that there isn't a huge amount of work to get between that initial stage and something that you're really depending on, really trusting, really, you know, something that is operationalized in your business.
So an ideal future for you would be what? What are you expecting from, or what are you hoping from the future of robotics?
I think the velocity that the community is generated in the last few years is the most exciting thing. So I think it's less about whether we're there or not, or when will we have Rosie. It's how do we preserve the inertia of the community? There's so much progress right now that we are moving towards that future. So I think it's really about preserving that, the speed at which we're marching into that future. It's less about when will I get to the future, and it's more about how fast are we moving in the right direction?
Once these tools are available at like a reasonable price, and then you have like an open source community of engineers working with those robots, imagine like where that can possibly go, right? That's really exciting to think about for me.
Just kind of playing off that a little bit, we're already seeing evidence of this cycle right now. So if you go back 5 to 10 years, there was a very small number of people making robots out in the real world, outside of our buildings, off of a pedestal, truly mobile robots. Some of the most exciting examples were vacuum cleaners, you know, not too long ago. I think we're seeing the era of the robotic startup right now. It may not be completely in the open source community yet, but you're seeing startup after startup starting, and within a year or two, having really interesting, compelling results. Why is that? Well, that's because we've commoditized so much stuff already. And when you combine the commoditization of all the core technologies and you add in all of the progress in AI, we're in that phase now. We're in that phase where you can start a small business and you can make a robot, and you can make that robot do something impressive, and you can make that robot demonstrate commercial value. And so I think we're at the very start of this massive acceleration of progress, because it's no longer just a few academic labs or a few very talented small groups of people. It's now become this amazing, frothy space of startups and exciting energy and money and investment. So I think we're seeing it right now.